Good morning. Welcome to LCM. We are delighted you are here. Wherever you are in your spiritual journey, whoever you are welcome. And God's grace is here. God's love is here. And we are delighted to be able to worship our God of love and grace with you today. We have so many announcements today. I'm not going to do them all because you'd get really bored. But please do read your news items in your bulletin. I'm going to highlight just a couple. There's a blood drive today at Holy Shepherd. We are invited to join them and help out that way. If you're able to do that, please do. I am looking for help with the Easter egg hunt, which we are going to be able to do this year, I think, because we have some kids. Yay! And we also have Easter eggs. So what you can help out with is stuffing some Easter eggs with allergy-friendly or unfriendly, I guess, things that don't have are not common allergens. Stay away from nuts, eggs, that sort of thing. Put in some jelly beans, put in some toys, and bring those eggs and stick them in the basket over there. And if you are willing to help out with hiding eggs or supervising the egg hunt on Easter, please let me know because I would love your help. I can only be in so many places at once. Also, I would love to get to know you even better. Some of you I've gotten to know well. Some of you I still haven't gotten to know. I'm going to be at Hello Coffee on Thursdays from 10 to 12, and I invite you to join me there. If you're not into coffee or into bigger groups, if lots of people show up, I would love to meet with you any other time. My email is in the bulletin. Just send me an email and I will come to you. You can come to me. We can party it up however you want to, Lutheran style. I don't know exactly what that means yet, but I'm learning. All right, let's begin our worship.
The only announcement I'll make is I'm feeling a certain vibe, a good vibe at LCM lately, and it's great just to see the full seats and a lot of things going on. So I'm just going to put a little prayer in for that and just announce that as a public acknowledgement. So, okay, let us pray together. Holy God, through your Son, you have called us to live faithfully and act courageously. Keep us steadfast in your covenant of grace and teach us the wisdom that comes only through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns you with the Holy Spirit. One God, now and forever. Amen.
Let's sing our kids to Sunday school. Rise in body or in spirit. Let us worship God who has done great things.
Let us rejoice in our God who has made a way through the desert of this world.
Let us worship God who has caused streams of mercy to flow in wasteland places.
For we are the people God has formed through Christ.
I invite you this day to give unto God all you are. Let us worship in spirit and in truth with all our heart, mind, body, and soul.
Let us
praise God for the grace that continues to save us. Let us worship and rejoice.
Please be seated. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who writes the laws on our hearts, who draws all people together through Jesus. Amen. Held in God's mercy, let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Holy God, we confess that we are caught in snares of sin and cannot break free. We hoard resources while our neighbors are hungry and cold. We speak in ways that silence others. We are silent when we should speak up. We keep score in our hearts. We let hurts go into hatred. For all these things and for sins only you know. Forgive us, Lord. Amen. Here is a flood of grace. Out of love for the whole world, God draws near to us, breaks every snare of sin, washes away our wrongs, and restores the promise of life through Jesus Christ. Amen.
The first reading this morning is from the book of Exodus, the 20th chapter. God spoke all of these words: I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven or above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I am Lord your God, and I am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquities of parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make a wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not work or do any work. You, your son or your daughter, male or female slave, your livestock, or your alien residents in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, but rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed it, the Sabbath day, and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house, nor shall you covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way of the Lord.
Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
The Passover was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Judeans then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." They then said to him, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Imagine you have spent years enslaved, certain your God has abandoned you. And then you have witnessed miracle after miracle. Seas have parted, a pillar of fire has led you. You have been fed literally by bread from heaven. You are free and surrounded by the care of your God. After years of having no choices, no rights, you can go and do anything. You are free. Often when people are released from prison, what they struggle with the most is the unstructured nature of freedom and choice. A supermarket aisle offering 40 boxes of cereal can feel panic-inducing. After having no choice about what to eat or where to go, suddenly there are 40 choices to sort through just to buy something for breakfast. We all long for freedom. But it is also overwhelming. My favorite rendition of the Ten Commandments story comes from Godly Play, a Montessori method of storytelling, and some of you may have seen me tell the story a few months ago. It's called The Ten Best Ways, and it begins, "Now the people are free. They can go anywhere they want to go and do anything they want to do. Where will they go now? What is the best way?" God loved the people so much that God showed them the 10 best ways to live. Sometimes these ways are called the Ten Commandments. These laws and other guidance given as God establishes a covenant with the newly freed people serve as a path through freedom, a path through their new life. They are the stones that make the way. Rather than being confining, this path is liberating, giving God's people what they need to navigate freedom and life with one another and with their God. Of course, the Ten Commandments are just a tiny portion of the Hebrew law code and of the guidance that God provides to us. And what's interesting is that it's money and the right use of money and resources and treatment of the poor that comes up throughout the Hebrew Bible or Old Testament more than almost any subject. The prophets reserve their greatest ire for those who are exploiting the poor or hoarding resources. Jubilee years provide for the canceling of all debt and the redistribution of land and resources, a sort of economic reset to ensure fairness and freedom for all. These laws were meant to liberate, to give a shape to freedom that brought life and abundance to all. And then in the New Testament, we come to the Roman occupation of Israel and Jesus' entrance on the scene. Jesus is known for breaking religious laws and secular traditions that have been twisted so they were no longer liberating. Jesus befriends those Rome and corrupt religion made into outcasts. Jesus has become the hope of liberation for so many. And then he tears into the temple. The temple is supposed to be the heart of religion, that place that connects us to the liberating covenant between God and God's people. but it had become a marketplace that served oppressive Rome and oppressive religion, not the God who brought Israel out of slavery and showed them the best way to live. You've heard of megachurches. You've seen megachurches. Well, this temple put all of them to shame. Rising 10 stories in the air, the temple covered 36 acres. Each stone measured 8 feet to a side. Snow-white marble and gold plated its walls, and when the sun hit it, it glowed. On the holiest of days, millions from around Israel traveled to Jerusalem to worship inside these splendid walls. With God housed in its Holy of Holies, it was the core of what it meant to be Jewish, the soul of Judaism. But the temple that Jesus knew was a strange mix. Originally, it was rebuilt by Jews who returned from the Babylonian exile, longing to once again have a place of worship worthy of their God. Then, much later, it had become one of the pet projects of Herod the Great, that mass-murdering, paranoid king of Israel who had tried to slaughter Jesus when he was an infant. Though Herod had made the temple into a magnificent space for Jews to worship, it was also a symbol of Roman oppression and of Herod's corruption and lust for power. Case in point, at the main entrance, Herod had placed a huge Roman eagle, which the Jews considered an idol, a sacrilege. When a group of Torah students smashed it, Herod had them hunted down and killed them brutally. He put 46 leaders of the Sanhedrin, the rabbinical court, to death, and he appointed his own loyal high priest to ensure that no more uprisings would occur in the temple. Predictably, under his reign, the temple hierarchy had become hopelessly corrupt as wealthy religious leaders collaborated with the Romans to keep themselves in power. Roman rule, wealth, and a disregard for the poor and oppressed had woven themselves into the very fabric of temple life and worship. In addition, as Pastor Bill Wiley Kellerman writes, the temple really functioned as a bank. It was not only a source of loans for those with proper credit, but also the depository for records of indebtedness. High taxes and runaway interest rates had forced many small farmers into sharecropping and indentured slavery, making the temple instrumental in an oppressive system. By the time of Jesus, the high priesthood had become so entangled with the Roman occupation that it was all but a political patronage job appointed by Pilate and subject to purchase and bribe. A position once solitary and lifelong became temporary and vulnerable to whims and changes in the regime. The Sanhedrin, before whom Jesus and eventually the disciples were tried, was made up substantially of the Sadducean party, Jews who had land and whose economic interest in the status quo made them backers of the Pax Romana military order. So when Jesus goes to the front porch of the temple where the money changers have set up shop, he's not simply annoyed with the inflated price of doves. He has chosen the public place, which is the most visible symbol of complicity between the occupying forces and the religious authorities. The temple represents the intersection of the Roman money market and the local economy, the spiritual idolatry of the status quo power. It is the place of prayer that has been invaded by the clink of Roman coins changing hands. In driving the money changers out, Jesus performs a kind of material exorcism. For people interested in peace and justice, this story can be positively invigorating. Jesus, the liberator, drives out corruption and stands on the side of justice. But let's wait a minute. This is a story about churches. Before we start thinking about all of the places we'd like to overturn tables and drive out bad actors, let's do a Lenten self-reflection. If Jesus showed up here, what would Jesus see in the deep recesses of our hearts? What would he see that we have corrupted? If he came to our church or any church, because we're all imperfect, what would he want to drive out? That is a truly uncomfortable question. But it is Lent, and this is the time for us to look inward and clean house. We long to be people of prayer, people of love, We long to be a church of liberating religion. But here we are as humans. And inevitably, we let Rome in. Injustices, collusion with corrupt power, attitudes that hurt others. I have nothing in mind as I preach this. I don't know what God might be leading us to reform in our own hearts and lives, or even here at LCM, or in the ELCA, or in the church at large. But I know there is always space in our imperfect world for reformation. Today's story calls us into self and communal reflection on who we are and who God calls us to be. And it invites us to let the disruptive Jesus, consumed with zeal for God's house, loose in our lives and in our church. Let's let Jesus clean house. At the end of our gospel story, Jesus equates his own body with the temple and says that the sign that he has the right to cleanse the temple will be his death and resurrection. We too are pointed to Jesus. Our church means nothing if its heart is not Jesus and his liberating love and promise of abundant life for all. So as we walk ever closer to Jesus's death this Lent, we know that the resurrection is on the other side. There are things in our hearts, in our church, in every heart and every church that need to die so that Christ's life can more brightly shine in and through us. But we need not fear. The Jesus who drives out injustice, corruption, and those things that keep us and others from God is also zealously on our side. Death, cleansing, cleaning house, that's hard. But just as God gave God's people the 10 best ways to guide them into freedom, God gives us his very death, life, and example to follow in Christ. And it will lead us to true and abundant life, not just for each of us, but for the world through us as we offer our church and our lives to follow the way of love and liberation that Christ has laid out for us. This summer, we will spend some time reflecting on what it means for us to be a church through a 6-week Sunday morning series called Why Church. More details are coming soon, but I hope that series of sermons and after church workshops will give us a chance to do some discernment about what we can do to be the best LCM possible, how we can hear and follow God's call to reform what needs to be reformed and to strengthen what is already so good. And there is so much that is already so good. As we go out this week, let's pray, let's read our scripture, let's reflect and listen to the Jesus who will help us reform our lives and the church if we just let him, who will lead us toward abundant life for all. Let's follow Jesus. Let's clean house. Let's even turn over tables that need to be overturned. And let's drive out what needs to go. And as we do, let's remember that God is with us and resurrection is on the way. Amen. As you feel led, please recite with me the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Morning, trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things. Let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, a world in need, and for us as well. Gracious and loving God, you alone are God. We thank you for the gift of the Sabbath rest. Awaken the church to the ministry of your presence and give us glad hearts as we receive the good news of your deliverance. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You renew creation, drive out greedy desires that would make the earth a marketplace. Protect rainforests, mountaintops, oceans, and wilderness areas from commercial exploitation. Unite nations, policymakers, and businesses in efforts to reduce carbon emissions. Turn the tables of those who would do evil in this world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You judge the nations. We pray for an end to war and to strife in every land. Strengthen international efforts to negotiate peace and provide for humanitarian aid to people fleeing from conflict. Hear us, O God. Healing God, you bring us healing and hope. We give thanks for physicians, nurses, researchers, therapists, and public health workers who prevent and treat illness. We pray for any of those who are sick or dealing with any medical issues, especially those that we now name out loud or silently in our hearts. For Dee, and prayers for Dean. Hear us, O God.
He is great.
You abide with your people. Sustain any in this community undergoing life transitions, marriage, divorce, childbirth, adoption, moving, graduation, employment, change, or any other sort of change in life. Or a death in the family. Today especially, we remember Karen Mina, Marsha Pitter, Ed Benetta, and those departed that we now name out loud or silently in our hearts. Your mercy is great. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord, conversely, you bring life from death. We pray for those preparing for baptism, whether young or old. We remember our loved ones who have died, confident that they have new life in you. May we trust that nothing can separate us from your love. Hear us, O God. Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please greet one another in the name of the Lord. I love that the hand sanitizer has become a holy part of our worship. Hospitality in the form of a warm welcome is generosity embodied. When we welcome each child of God into the life of this church, we extend God's own generous hospitality. Our gifts help LCM's ministry to flourish and to grow and to give glory to God. Let us gather all of our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and in praise. We do not pass a plate here at LCM, but we invite you to leave a gift in the plates in the back or to give online through the QR code or the link. We also invite you to update your contact information and the notes in the back of the chairs or to share prayer requests. Blessed are you, Holy One. Jesus, you are the bread of life and the host of this meal. Bless these gifts that we have gathered, that all people may know your goodness. Feed us not only with holy food, but with hunger for justice and peace. We pray this in your name. Amen. Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
It is right to give our thanks and praise. Oh, you were supposed to say that. Sorry. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your spirit poured out on all nations. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and this cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Come, Holy Spirit. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love. Come, Holy Spirit. With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with the sun, moon, and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. We lift our prayer to you using the words recited by all generations. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please come forward as the host directs you. If you prefer to receive communion in your seat, please just let a host know, and I will bring God's gifts to you. Here we pour wine or grape juice into individual cups, so please take an individual cup. The first cup is wine, the second is grape juice, and we also have gluten-free wafers. Just let me know if you need one of those. Bread for the journey, a feast for hungry hearts, come. Thank you. please rise in body or in spirit. Generous God, at this table we have tasted your immeasurable grace. Of grains of wheat are gathered into one bread. Now make us one loaf to feed the world. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life. Amen. Beloved, we are God's own people, holy, washed, renewed. God bless you and keep you and shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and give you peace.
Did you all notice that we were checking if you were paying attention, both of us, when we both messed up during the service? So, all right. Thank you for that, by the way, Pastor. Go in peace. Share the bread. Thanks be to God.